This session we'll see about pharmacotherapy of hypothyroidism. To give an overview of what are we going to see in this session, we'll see about the etiopathogenesis and the treatment strategy. We'll see what to replace, when to treat, how much to start, how to monitor, how to titrate therapy, and what to do if the targets are not achieved and when to stop. Now let's first go to the etiopathogenesis of this disease. The most common cause for hypothyroidism worldwide is iodine deficiency. In iodine sufficient areas, the most common cause is autoimmune thyroiditis. Called as Hashimoto's thyroiditis. The other causes for hypothyroidism, it can be congenital either due to the dysgenesis of thyroid gland itself or due to any inborn errors of metabolism, or it can be due to drugs can also be a cause for hypothyroidism. Two drugs which are worth remembering. The first is amiodarone. Amiodarone is very peculiar because amiodarone can cause both hypothyroidism as well as hyperthyroidism. Other drug which is very notable to cause hypothyroidism is lithium. So these are the causes for or etiological agents for hypothyroidism. Note about the pathogenesis of this autoimmune thyroiditis. Many patients have what is called as thyroid peroxidase antibodies, anti-thyroid peroxidase antibodies. Thyroid peroxidase is an enzyme involved in the synthesis, and they develop antibodies to this, and this is one of the markers to identify the cause of hypothyroidism. Right? So that's about the etiology. Now let's see about the treatment strategy. The strategy becomes very simple here because whenever there is a deficiency of an endogenous substance or a hormone, we have to replace. So we need to do replacement therapy. So that's the basic strategy for treating hypothyroidism. Now comes the question of which hormone to be replaced. You all know that the thyroid gland has two hormones. The first is tetrahydrothyronine, which is the most major hormone, and there is another hormone called triiodothyronine. So this is called as thyroxine. Our strategy, okay, now we are convinced that we need to replace. Now should we use T4 or should we use T3, or there is another strategy of a combination of T4 plus T3. Now which among these three should be used? Let's have a quick look at it. Now if we are going to use T3 alone, it has been found that this leads to increased cardiac failure because of its rapid effect. That is the first and the most important reason why T3 should not be used for the routine replacement therapy of hypothyroidism. There are two more reasons why T3 is not preferred. It has a short half-life when compared to T4, and because of this, we need to administer it repeatedly. The dosing is thrice daily dosing needs to be given, and because of this, maintaining smooth levels becomes difficult. Smooth maintenance level becomes very difficult. The third reason why T3 is not preferred is it is costly when compared to T4. So these are the three reasons why T3 is not preferred for the routine replacement therapy. Now, T4 plus T3, again if you look into, now in our body physiologically there is always a mix of T4 plus T3 is always present. So this looks like a more physiological way in which we can replace. But the problem with combining T4 plus T3 for routine replacement therapy is that all trials and studies have shown that this is not superior to T4 alone. So again, the mix of combining T4 plus T3 is also not a preferred strategy for replacement. So the drug of choice as far as the replacement therapy goes is T4 or thyroxine. Now there are two forms of thyroxine available. We for replacement therapy for hypothyroidism use the levo form or levothyroxine. The dextro isomer of thyroxine, called as D-thyroxine, was previously used as a cholesterol lowering agent, but it is not used now at all. So just waiting for the moment. So levothyroxine is the drug of choice for replacement therapy for hypothyroidism. Now let us go to the next point. When should we decide to treat a patient? So when to treat? So we have seen what to treat with. So now when to treat? Now two clinical entities are there: overt hypothyroidism and subclinical hypothyroidism. What do we mean by this? Patient has signs and symptoms of the disease. He also has biochemical evidence of hypothyroidism. What do you mean by biochemical evidence of hypothyroidism? They have increased TH test level and reduced free T4 levels. So these patients should be treated with replacement dose of levothyroxine. Now, what is subclinical thyroidism? They have biochemical evidence of hypothyroidism, but no apparent signs or symptoms. Now, when should we treat subclinical thyroidism? There are no clear-cut guidelines, but what has been accepted widely is if TSH level is greater than 10 milliunits per liter, then these patients have a high chance of progressing to overt hypothyroidism and they need to be treated. If a patient with high TSH also has thyroid peroxidase antibodies are present, then they also have a high incidence of progressing to overt hypothyroidism, then they need to be treated. So these are the two indications or two conditions wherein you will treat a patient with subclinical hypothyroidism. So that's about when to treat. So we have seen what to use for treatment, we have seen when to treat. Now let's see how to monitor once we have or what dose should we start, then we will see how to start. So when to treat we have seen, how much to start. Now the usual adult dose for initiating treatment is 50 micrograms per day, given as a single daily dosage. In elderly people, the starting dose is usually low. Why? Because they have a more chance of getting adverse effect with this drug. Either it is 12.5 or 25 micrograms per day. Now, in children, we have a slightly different or a paradoxical thing. Usually, for most of the drugs, the kilogram, the dose per kilogram body weight for children is usually low. But for treatment of hypothyroidism with levothyroxine, children have a higher per kilogram dose, higher dose per kilogram body weight. Because you all know that thyroid hormone is involved in the growth and differentiation, and children have a high or in a growth stage, isn't it? And their metabolic rate is also high. So obviously they need more thyroid hormone. That's why the dose for children per kilogram body weight is usually more when compared to the adult. So what is the dose to be started? Right. Now, how to monitor? Let's see the next thing, how to monitor these patients. Once we have started, say for example, in an adult patient with 50 micrograms per day, then how to monitor? Monitoring is done by two factors. The first and the most important being TSH. The second is free T4 levels. These are the two biochemical parameters which are used for monitoring a patient who is started on levothyroxine. Now, how early should we monitor? Once you start treatment or once you change the dose, at least after 2 to 3 months, you can measure TSH level and free T4 levels to them. Now, the TSH level in a normal person is 0.45 milliunits per liter to 4.5 milliunits per liter. What is the level or what is the target of TSH in a patient, in an adult who is having hypothyroidism? Is that this is less than half, it should be maintained in the lower half of normal limit. What do we mean by that? So this is 0.45 to 4.5. So something around 2 to 2.5 milliunits per liter will be the maintenance, will be the target TSH level for maintaining in a patient with hypothyroidism. So that's how to monitor. Now, how to titrate therapy? Let's see how to titrate the dose. Titration of dose is done in increments of 12.5 micrograms per day. So once you look into the TSH level as target, if it is not attained, say the lower half of the normal limit is not attained, if the TSH is high, then you need to increase the dose of the levothyroxine. Or if the TSH level is less, then you need to reduce the dose of the, so either increments or decrements is done in the magnitude of 12.5 micrograms per day. Now again, if you change the dose, again you need to give a time period of 2 to 3 months, then again you have to test and go on. So that's how you titrate. Now for adult, this is how we will proceed. Now for children, as a special case, now we know that children have a very fast growing rate, and you can check even around at 2 months. In adult, if you see, once in 3 months you can, after 3 months of changing a dose, you need to check whether TSH is maintained. Once it comes to the stable level TSH, for the first year you need to check every 6 monthly and later on every year. Now this does not happen with children because they have a fast growing rate and their amount of requirement also keep changing. So we need to do it more frequently. So every 6 monthly, what we taught after stabilization in an adult is not applicable in child, and we need to do that frequently because they are in a growing stage. Now, if you look into pregnant women, how early or how frequently we need to monitor, this is done once in a month. So, monthly once, we need to check and titrate and monitor the TSH level in a pregnancy. So that's how do we titrate and go about. Now, when we try to titrate and go about, we need to remember one thing, that overt or aggressive treatment should always be avoided. This is a very important point to note, because aggressive treatment can lead to increased risk of myocardial ischemia and arrhythmia. So it is very important to know that we should not be over enthusiastic in treating a patient with hypothyroidism, then we will be landing up in either arrhythmia or ischemia or sometimes even heart failure. So how to monitor, how to titrate, we have seen. Now, what to do if not controlled. The usual maintenance dose, so the usual dose of replacement in women, if you look into, it is usually 75 to 150 micrograms per day. In an adult man, it is around 100 to 200 micrograms per day. This is the usual maintenance dose, and many patients will be maintained within this range. Now, what should we do, or what will happen if this, some patients might need a more dose, say for example more than 200 micrograms per day, but still their target TSH is not reached, or the TSH level is very much elevated. Now, what to do for these kind of patients? Now, we need to check 3 or 4 more things before we come to a conclusion. Now, the first thing which needs to be checked for these kind of patients who have reached around 200 micrograms per day but still their target TSH is not rescued, the first thing is compliance. One of the important issues in treating patients with hypothyroidism is that even if they miss 1 or 2 doses of levothyroxine, their symptom is not going to change. So what happens, once they are become stabilized, they tend to miss the pills, they don't have any overt symptoms just because they miss, and this becomes their habit. So we need to check whether the patient is compliant or irregularly taking treatment. One biochemical feature which will help us deciding or to find out whether the patient is really compliant or not is that if we measure the TSH level and free T4 levels, if TSH level is high and if free T4 levels are normal, then it indicates that the patient has taken the drug just before the physician visit, so that the free T4 levels are normal or slightly on the higher side, whereas it takes more time for the patient to bring his TSH levels down. So this, if he has a picture like this, then it gives a very high suspicion that this patient is taking drugs just before the physician visit is scheduled. So this is one way in which you can find. You can directly ask the patient also, and you can check his compliance. So the first thing which needs to done is we need to check the compliance. The second important instruction which we need to give to the patient while we prescribe this drug levothyroxine is that the timing in which the patient has to take. The absorption of this drug will be reduced by food, and this should be always taken half an hour before food, preferably breakfast. Now, they also need to have a routine, and they need to take it every day at the same time to make smoother control. So this, you need to take it daily during breakfast. This maintains routine, keeps the compliance, and also it helps in the better control. So second thing, advise him on the timings, ask him to take it at the same time during every day. The third important consideration which you need to take while handling this patient is the issue of bioequivalence. Now, T4 or levothyroxine is a drug which has low therapeutic index, and changing the brand can sometimes lead to higher or lower levels which are detrimental. So patients are advised to take the same brand of levothyroxine whenever they are going in for a refill. Now, in case they could not get the same brand and they are having or changing a brand, they should tell to the practitioner, and we should measure TSH and T4 levels again, free T4 levels, to check and to titrate the dose. So again, after 2 to 3 months of changing the brand, we have to do that, and this needs to be stabilized. So the third issue of bioequivalence, and the fourth important issue is that, are they taking other drugs which can interfere with the action? Now, two drugs which can interfere with the absorption, which are commonly used, one is the iron tablets, ferrosulfate tablets. The second drug is calcium supplementation. These two drugs are known to decrease the absorption of levothyroxine, and if at all a patient really requires iron, ferrosulfate and calcium, at least there should be a time gap of 4 hours between these two drugs, levothyroxine and any of these calcium preparations, or at least a time gap of 4 hours needs to be there. Some drugs can also increase the metabolism of levothyroxine and thereby reduce the drug levels attained by levothyroxine. Say for example, phenytoin, carbamazepine, rifampin, all these drugs can reduce the drug level by increasing the metabolism of levothyroxine. So these are four factors which we need to consider when a patient is saying or is not able to attain the target TSH level in spite of going to drug levels like, say for example, 200 micrograms. Now lastly, when should we stop the drug? Now the treatment for hypothyroidism is lifelong. So we need to reassure the patient that he has to take treatment for lifelong. One more point which we need to reassure the patient while we initiate treatment is that the TSH level might come to a normal, but his symptoms will come back. It will take at least 3 to 6 months after normalization of TSH levels to reduce or to make the symptom, make the patient nil symptomatic. So this also needs to be reassured to the patient so that he is compliant to therapy, and the treatment is lifelong. We need to tell to them. And one more point regarding when to stop. If we are doing an over enthusiastic treatment, then what happens sometimes, the patient might present with, say for example, myocardial ischemia or arrhythmia. Now if your patient on high dose of levothyroxine presents with any of these things, then we need to stop treatment for at least 1 week. So at least 1 week you need to stop treatment, and you have to treat the patient symptomatically. After this has been taken care of, you can restart the patient at a very low dose. We have already seen here, when we are trying to what to start, we saw that in elderly people, we always start at a low dose of 12.5 or 25. Same way, patients who are having cardiovascular disorders or other comorbid conditions, we should always start with same dose. So here also, stop the drug for at least 1 week, or might be for a 2 week or 2 week period, then you can restart at a lower dose. So that's about when to stop. So now to summarize this session, iodine deficiency is the most common cause in iodine for hypothyroidism. In iodine sufficient areas, autoimmune thyroiditis is the most common cause. Replacement therapy with levothyroxine is preferred. In adults, the starting dose is 50 micrograms, It is titrated in a dose of 12.5 micrograms per day. Usually, it is monitored after a period of 2 to 3 months by checking the TSH and free T4 levels. The treatment is lifelong. Concomitant drugs, compliance, bioequivalence, other factors which play a role in maintaining the proper control of TSH, and these need to be looked into. So that's all. Thank you very much. If you have any doubts, please get back. Thank you.